So welcome everybody to this prize lecture by Phan-Chan Nam. It's a great honor for me to introduce Nam, and I'm of course particularly very proud because Nam was my PhD student. He got his PhD 10 years ago from the University of Copenhagen, and then he has had positions in Vienna, Paris, Prague, and now he's a professor in Munich, and I can see he's sitting in his office in Munich. So among his groundbreaking contribution for which he was awarded this EMS prize, we can mention that he has proved the best known constant for the ionization of atoms. He also has the best result on the best constant for the Lieb-Thiering inequality, not the Sharpe constant, but the best known constant in the Lieb-Thiering inequality. He is famous for having developed the Finetti approach to proving mean field limit for both systems. And he has established the validity of the Bogoliubov approximation for the excitation spectrum of Bose gases. And this is what he will tell us about today. He will talk about excitation spectrum of dilute trapped Bose gases. Let me just say that if you have any questions along the way, you can put them in the question and answer in the chat, or you can raise your hand. In the end, we will take more questions. So Nam, please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. And some flip for the guys' introductions. And and I thank the organizer for giving me the chance to talk today. So actually the topic I will report today is this goes back to a subjection that some clip introduced to me about more than 10 years ago when I was in Copenhagen. So I hope that you will personally enjoy. Okay, so let me share my screen and we'll continue. Okay, so today I will talk about recent joint work with Arnold Trai, who is also in MU Munich. So first, the motivation of our work comes from the phenomenon called the Bose-Einstein condensation. So this the phenomenon when you cool down the Bose gas to a very low temperature, then many particles can occupy the same quantum state. This phenomenon already predicted by Bose and Einstein about 1924, but this took quite a long time when this can be produced in the lab. And this was celebrated by the Nobel Prize in Physics of Cornell, Whitman, and Catalas for their work in 1995. So in particular, the Bose-Einstein condensations is interesting because it gives us the chance to observe many interesting quantum effects in a macroscopic scale, for example, the superfluidity. So today I will try to give you some insight about this phenomenon from a mathematical point of view. Okay, so although the superfluidity is already observed or realized in 1938, but this was only explained systematically by Landau in a famous paper in 41. And then a few years later, then Bogoliubov came up with an approximation theory when he can explain Landau criterion of superfluidity from a microscopic equation. And this is my job today to explain to you a mathematical proof of Bogoliubov theory from first principle, namely from the many body Schrödinger equation. So here the mathematical setting, I will consider a system of n bosons in three dimensions described by the following Hamiltonian. So any particles will have a kinetic energy described by the minor Lapsons, and they are trapped by an external potential that I assume to be non-negative and grow to infinity at infinities. We have an two-body interaction potential that is non-negative and short range. So in the meaning that the potential V here will be compactly supported, radial, and integrable. Moreover, we consider the rescale potentials such that the potential N square and VNS had the scattering length A0 over N, where A0 the scattering length of the potential V. So this the normal description of a diluted gas, because the range of the interaction potential proportional to 1 over N much smaller than the average distance of the particles. More precisely, because we get a trap system, then the system normally occupy a volume of order 1, and because we get the N particles, then the mean distance will be of the order N to the minus 1 third. Then in our system, then one particle just interact with very few other particles, and this the basis setting when people observe the Bose-Einstein condensations in the lab. So in that assumptions, we can see that the Hamiltonian Sn, this is non-negative, and this can be extended to be a positive Shell-Echon operator by the free risk extension, and this has come back resolved. Today, we will focus on the low line eigenvalues of these Hamiltonians in the limits when n converts to infinity. So to the leading order, the system is well described by the so-called Brod-Vitarsky functional. So this is a one-body functional. When you see the normal kinetic operator and the external potential there, but for the interaction path, then you replace the two-body potential by a local operators. So here you get integration u to the 4 coupled with a constant proportional to the scattering length of the norm of the previous interaction potential. So if you apply the normal mean field approximation, namely you want to restrict to the ansatz of the uncorrelated states, then you would normally tuck the Bill-Tensor Broder states. Namely, you would own n particle in the same quantum state. And if you calculate the ground state energy per particle of that state, then you would obtain a wrong functional. Namely, you get the so-called Hartree functional. This looks very similar to the Grabowski functional, but you get a wrong coupling constant. And actually, the V hat of zero, namely the integration of V, is the third point approximation of the scattering length that's defined properly by this formula. Okay, so this means that even to the leading order, you observe a subtle nonlinear correction. This comes from the strong correlation of particles in very short distance. And understanding this correction rigorously, this already a highly non-trivial task. So this problem was settled about 20 years ago in a series of paper by Lip, Sanger, and Invisons. So in 2000, then they proved that for any kth given, then the kth eigenvalues of the n-body Hamiltonians behave to the leading order like this expression. So you get n time of the Grabowski energies and supporter term. And later, Lip and Scharinger proved the so-called complex Bose-Einstein condensations for the corresponding eigenvectors of the Hamiltonian Sn. Namely, they proved that the number of particles inside the condensate mode phi, the Grabowski minimizers, is given by n and plus something smaller. So here I want to remark thus, you should not think of the eigenvectors close to the Bill-Tensor Broder state phi in norm. So the information of the complex condensation, this some weak notion of the closeness, and this has nothing to do with the norm topologies. And in particular, we will see that the distance from the eigenvectors to the Bill-Tensor state here, this actually bigger than something about the one. And today I will discuss about the next order correction to those formula. So the little o of n here will be actually about the one, and this can be given by Bokhlubov theory. So to describe the Bokhlubov reduction quickly, then let me focus only on the nonlinear functional. So we know that to the leading order, then the system is captured by the Grabowski functional. Now to get to the next order, and let's try to do the perturbation theory. So let me just do the Taylor expansion of the gravitas key around the minimizer phi. Namely, I take a vector phi that's orthogonal to phi. I consider the normalized function phi plus phi, and I do the expansion when v is small. Then I would get the energy of phi, and then the second order given by the Hessian matrix, where the Hessian can be calculated explicitly as a 2x2 block operator like that. Here, D is the mean field operator associated with the Gravitas-Key functional. So this just give you the Euler-Lyrian equation of the minimizer phi. And this Hessian matrix you can diagonalize by a real and symplectic matrix. Namely, you can find a 2x2 block operator V as the form like that, square root 1 plus S square and S, S1 square root 1 plus S square. This is not a unitary operator, but a symplectic operator. And when you conjugate the Hessian matrix with V, then you obtain the diagonal form where E, the one body operator, called the excitation operators. And this given explicitly in the following form. Right. So originally, the E can be verified as an operator in L2 or R3, but because D had phi as a ground state, if you want, you can just restrict E to the orthogonal space of phi, and this is a proper operator on the orthogonal space as well. Then now I'm able to state our main results. So this is the result I obtained only with NO3As, and this is available in a paper that we put on Akai today. So our result set as the following. For any given number k, in the limits when n converts to infinity, if you calculate the dip, if you calculate the gap between the two eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian Sn, then you find the finite sum of the eigenvalues of the excitation operator E. So here you are allowed to tuck any parameter ni, they are non-negative integers, and ni will be the strict positive eigenvalue of the operator E that I just discussed in the previous slide. Okay, so a similar result to us obtained independently by Rinecker, Sly, and Strivan will be appears in an incoming paper. So heuristically, our results give a justification for the fact that the n-body Hamiltonian up to a unitary will be equivalent to a non-interacting operator. So in particular, when you subtract for the ground state energy, you can think of this like a quantization of the one-body operator E and given by this expression. So remember that the right side here, this is an operator acting on Fock space of the excited particle. So in particular, we don't fit the number particle here. This leaves on the fact that the sum there, you don't put any constraint on the parameter little n of I. So this is not surprising because we are discussing about the excitations and the number of the excited particles can be arbitrary. Okay, so here's some earlier results. So in the last 10 years, then there's some remarkable progress toward the rigorous justification of Bohr global theories. About 10 years ago, then Schrödinger and Robert Schrödinger gave the first proof of the excitation spectrum in the mean field regimes. So in this case, then they replaced the Schrödinger interaction potential V by the following interaction n minus one V with V independent of N, and they produce a result very similar to our result in the previous slides, except that now the elementary excitations are eigenvalues of a one-body operator that's determined by the Hartree functional. After that work, then there are many extensions in many directions. So in my joint work with Levin, Serverty, and Solovay, we extend the result to a general class of interacting gas, so including the unbounded interaction potential. And then there is Zinsky and Bykovsky's proof the result for invariant system, but in some unbounded domains, and they took the last part limits. Later, there also the work when you don't have the complex Bose-Einstein condensations, but you get some fractional or multiple condensations, and the similar result also hold. So this done in my own work with Scharinger and another work of Rotary and Spener when they consider the double well potential when the distance of two well convert to infinities. And finally, there are also some progress to work to the next order expansion of the Bolopov theories. Namely, you are not only consider the correction of order one, but the correction of the order n to a negative power to a very high power. So this started with Bezos and then recently completed by Boltzmann, Weitrath, and Scharinger. So more or less, in the mean field regimes, then you can calculate the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian in any precision as you want. In the gravitational regimes, then the situation is more complicated. And in the last 2 years, then Boketo, Brinecker, Sinatiembo, and Sly prove a result similar to us in the situation of the homogeneous gas on the torus. So this invariant translation invariant system when you don't have the external potential. And in this case, the condensate is simply given by the function one. And you can calculate the elementary excitation explicitly. So this is given by these quantities. So the key feature of the elementary excitation in that case is the fact that if you calculate the infimum of the elementary excitation divided for the absolute value of P, and when you take the infimum when P different from zero, you get some strictly positive number. And this is exactly the one you need to verify Landau criterion for superfluidity. So put differently, up to a unitary transformation, your Hamiltonian will dominate the total momentum coupled with the constant C zero. And as a consequence, if you put a drop of velocity smaller than C zero, then the drop just a small perturbation of the system, and this will not going to change your ground state. Namely, the drop will move without any friction inside the ground state. For the general grab system in R3, then the situation will be even more complicated. In this case, the bad result now is the so-called optimal right of BEC. Namely, you can prove that the second order correction will be about a one. This first proof in my joint work with Bykovsky, Ricord, and Trier for small interaction potential, and recently proved in a more generalities by Brinecker, Sly, and Straven. So in the rest of the talk, then let me quickly explain to you how to make the connection from our result to the original subjection of Bolopov, and then explain to you how to formulate a mathematical proof of the result. So to discuss the Bolopov theories, then it's more convenient to turn to the setting of Fock space, because we're not going to fit the number of particles. So the Fock space is a Hilbert space when you put the direct sum of little n particles by for little n run from zero to infinities. And for any one body vector G, you can define the creation and analyzation operator on Fock space by the following axiom. So basically, the creation operator will add the function G with a new variables, and then you have to symmetrize them to get a bosonic state. And the analyzation operator just do the opposite. You Q1 particles by integrate out this against the function G. If you want, you can also define the operator value distribution, AS star and AH with S vector in three dimension, such that if you integrate out the operator value distribution against a vector G, you will obtain the original creation or analyzation operator. street that I just defined here. And those operators satisfy the so-called canonical commutation relations, namely creation two annihilation operator and two creation operator, they always commute. And when you do the commutator of one annihilation operator and one creation operator, you get the delta function. So using those operator, you can write conveniently your Hamiltonian in the second quantization language. So in particular, the Hamiltonian that I start with will be the same with the operator on the right side, although the operator on the right side makes sense as an operator on Fox space. So now I can start discuss about the heuristic argument of Bogolyubov in his original paper. So Bogolyubov suggests the following. First, let us focus on the second quantization of the Hamiltonian. And here, let me consider a general interaction potential of the form W divided for N. In the first step, Bogolyubov suggests that you can factor out the contribution of the condensates by replacing that with a scalar field. So differently, you can replace the annihilation operator AS by a complex number. We write here like square root N zero and then multiply with GS. G is the normalized function describe the condensations, and you add the annihilation operator but restricted to the excited Fox space. So if you do so, you will obtain the operators on the right side there. So this looks a bit complicated, but then Bogolyubov argued that because we had a full or the complex Bose-Einstein condensation, when you consider the number of particles outside of the condensate, then you get a contribution of the suborder. So formally, you can think of the CS like a small perturbation. Then you can ignore the own term when you so when you expand the Hamiltonian from the last line, you can ignore own term containing three or four operator CS, and you end up with the following approximations. So you get a constant something depend only on one operator C or C star, and the quadratic expression with the two C operator. Here, the leading orders is given by Hartree functional defined in that way. So because we are interested in the low energy spectrum, we will try to minimize the Hartree functional. So this gives you the Hartree minimizer G, and thus satisfy the Euler-Lagrange equation, namely dS of G equal to zero. And with this condition, then you see the linear term here will disappear. So basically, we are left with a quadratic expression in terms of C and C star. So in the next step of the Bogolyubov theory, then we can diagonalize the quadratic Hamiltonian by a unitary operator on Fox space. So the operator T defined by the following way, it map the annihilation operator into a combination of one annihilation operator and one creation operator, where the coefficient can be determined by a metric S. So if you remember the previous discussion on the perturbation theory with the Gravitsky functional, then the Bogolyubov having the Bogolyubov transformation T here is exactly associated with the symmetric matrix that I mentioned before. So if you do so and you choose the operator S precise, then you can diagonalize the operator and you obtain the final expression like that. So up to a constant, then you obtain the quantization of the one-body operator. This looks exactly like the operator that we discussed before, except now it determined by the Hartree functional. So it turned out that this approximation is correct in the mean field regimes when the interaction potential W is independent of N. However, in the dilute regimes, when the interaction potential is N square VNS, then this is wrong. So this is not surprising because we know to the leading order, we should see the Rapitasky functional rather than the Hartree functional. Okay, so how can we mark this correct? Then let me go a little bit more detail to the Hartree functional. So in the Rapitasky regimes, when the interactions proportional to N square and V and S, then the Hartree functional look at follow. And when N convert to infinity, then you see that you recover the nonlinear term integration G to the 4 with the coupling constant we had 0 over 2. Then this subject, the last step of the transformation, namely for the dilute limits, everywhere when you find the V hat of zero, you should replace this by the A pi I zero when A zero the scattering length of V. So if you accept this and do the formal substitution, then you will end up with the following approximation. So namely up to a constant, you will get the one body excitation operator E. This is exactly the one from the Gravitasky functional I discussed before. Okay, so in the last part of the talk, then let me try to explain to you how to mark the heuristic argument of Pavlov regress. So let us start from the quantization of the form of the n-body Hamiltonian. Then roughly speaking, we will offer a rigorous formulation of Pavlov approximation in the following sense. So if you put an n-body Hamiltonian Sn there, you can find four unitary operator U, T1, Tc, and T2, such that up to those transformation, you will extract the correct ground state energies, and then you see the quantization of the excitation operator. So basically, we follow a general approach proposed before by Boketo, Brinecker, Sinatiembo, and Sly when they consider the homogeneous gas on the torus. But here we have to tack slightly different transformation to simplify the analysis and also to generalize this to deal with the inhomogeneous system in R3. So let me explain one of the four operator here in the next slide. First, we have the excitation operator U. This was introduced in my son work with Devin, Sabati, and Solovice. So our starting point is the observation that given any one, but given any n-body operator beside n, you can only write this uniquely in the following form. So first, you put n particles in phi, and this comes with a complex number psi zero. Then you have n minus one particle in phi. You have to tuck the tensor with a one-body operator live in the orthogonal space to phi, and then you get you put the n minus two particles in phi, and you get a tensor with a two-body operator on the orthogonal space, and so on. So the definition of the unitary operator use is very simple. You just need to remove or eliminate all of the contribution from the condensation phi here on the right side, and you obtain a collection of a collection of the operator as orthogonal to phi. So here you get the psi zero, psi one, up to psi n, they live in the so-called truncated Fock space. So this is the Fock space built up from the orthogonal space of phi, but you mark the truncation in terms of a number of particles. This operator U actually a unitary operator, and this axons can be traced by the following identities. Namely, this will map the analyzation operator A to square root of n minus n plus, with n plus the number of particles, multiplied with phi, and plus with the CS. So the analyzation operator, but projected on the orthogonal space. So when you get the complete Bose-Einstein condensations, then in expectation, the n plus is much smaller than n. And then square root of n minus n plus behave just like square root of n. So in this form, the operator use give us a rigorous tool to justify the Pavlov C number substitutions. Then when we use the U, you can calculate this explicitly. So this given by operator H live in the full Fock space, and then you have to project it. This to the n particle space or less than, and the operator S is given explicitly as follows. So this looks a bit complicated, but here you just need to focus on the last two terms with the three operator C and four operator C. So in the Bogolubov original subjection, he said that you just do the second order expansion, namely you should ignore those terms L3 and L4. However, in the Gravitaski regime, then it turned out that the L4 will have a contribution about the N, and L3 has a contribution about the 1. Those. So these terms could not be ignored and have to be renormalized properly by another two unitary transformation, T2 and T3. So put differently, we will implement the second and the fourth step in Bogolubov theories at the same time. So to formulate the first quadratic transformation T1, the one that factor out the correct leading order energy about the N, we have to understand the correlation structure of particles. And for that, then let us come to the scattering equation. So from the definition of the scattering length, you can prove that there exists an optimizer F for the minimization problem, and this satisfies the following equation with the boundary condition that F convert to 1 and infinity. And if you consider the function omega equal to 1 minus F, you can prove that omega behave like a zero divided by S when S convert to infinity. However, by technical reason, we will want to remove the long range contribution from the omega. For that, we introduce the so-called rescale and truncated functions. So we define the function omega L1 N given by omega with the variables S replaced by NS. And we also put together with the cutoff chi, where chi basically the smooth version of the characteristic function of a bone. So if you insert the function omega here to the scattering equation, you will not get the result zero, but you get the some error, and this will be encoded in the function epsilon. So using those functions, we can define the unitary global transformation on four space by the following action. So this map the analyzer operator C to C plus C star, where the coefficient determined by an operator S1, where the kernel of S1 is given by the following form, where you get the condensate phi and the scattering or the truncated scattering solution omega L1n. So if you insert this transformation and you choose the parameter L1, much smaller than n but much bigger than 1, then you obtain the following expression. So basically, you extract the correct leading order contribution of the Hamiltonian, and you renormalize the short range potential V n of S minus y in the quadratic term by a longer range operator that we call the epsilon. So remember that in our convention, then the epsilon is supported in the domain with the length scale L1 divided by n, where the original Hamiltonian, the original potential had a length scale 1 over n. Then when you put L1 much bigger than 1, then the potential here this had a much longer length scale. And moreover, if you do the integration of the function epsilon, you obtain exactly a pi time of the scattering length, not only the integration of V in the Hartree theory. So the ideas of using the transformation like T1 actually goes back to the work of Benedicta de Oliveira and Sly, and also by Benedicta and Sly more recently in the context of quantum dynamics. So in those work, they took a similar transformation, but they have L1 proportional to N in order to obtain the optimal right of BC. So here the important difference is we will take L1 much smaller than N, such that in some sense our transformation is smaller than their transformation, and it's easier to control the error. So in practice, our transformation T1 will not change the cubic term L3. That is important for the next step. So next, then, because as I told you, the first quadratic transformation is not going to do anything for the qubit term, then this is still basically about a one. Then to remove that, we apply another qubit transformation of a form that the boot exponential of S star minus S, where S given by the following form. So when we choose the parameter M for the truncation on number particle here, and L2 in the scattering solution here, much smaller than N and much bigger than one, then the action of the qubit transformation is pretty easy to control. So we can use the symbol commutator form like that. And in particular, here we use the kernel S exactly such that you get the nice cancellation there. So if you plug the commutator with the kinetic and with the L4 contribution, you kill exactly the qubit term. And this end up, this gives you an approximation where you obtain something extremely similar to what I wrote before, except that now we don't have the qubit term L3 anymore. So the use of the qubit transformation, this was introduced before by Boccato, Reinecker, Snell-Chambers, and Sly. And this is a crucial step to obtain the excitation spectrum. Here we basically follow the same approach, but our choice of the transformation, this is simpler because in the previous step, we didn't change the qubit term L3. And then now we are in the last step. After the qubit transformation, we basically end up with a quadratic expression. So as I told you before, the kernel epsilon here is somehow the long range kernel. And for that, we more or less in the mean field regimes. So to deal with this quadratic expression, we can try to diagonalize this explicitly using the transformation introduced in the paper of Craig and Scharinger in the mean field regimes. This will give the final expression here when you extract the right constant and you see the quantization of an effective one body operator with an etula defined explicitly here. And finally, again, in the our regime, because the L1 much smaller than N, the operator E tilde here will convert to the operator E in the Grabitaski theory, at least in the resolvent sense, because the function N3 and epsilon L1 and S here will convert to a delta function. And the mass given explicitly by the number A pi A0. So, this is the last step of the proof. So because still, so before finish, then let me mention an open problem that's related to the topic. So from the physical point of view, then this would be very interesting if we can understand the interacting gas in the thermodynamic limits. Namely, we put N bosonic particles in the last torus. You get a translation invariant system and you can see the limits when the number of particles convert to infinities, the size of the box convert to infinities, and at the same time, you keep the density of the system. Then the conjecture here is in the thermodynamic limits, if you have the non-negative interaction, you should obtain the Bose-Einstein condensations. Namely, if you define the condensation state phi just a constant in the Bose, renormalized, then the expectation of particles inside of the most phi divide for number of particles and will be bounded from below by a number C0 that is strictly positive and independent of L and M. So here we don't know any result about these reactions, but the bad result the thermodynamic limits is the ground state energies. So at least in the dilute limits, when you allow the density rho convert to zero, then we know that the ground state energy of particles will be described by the Li Huang Yang formula. So this formula was predicted by a method similar to Bogolubov approximations, and you get the leading order for pi a zero rho. This this is similar to the gravitational energies, and you get the next order correction. So this formula was proved first by Dyson and Lips in Dyson for the leading order, and then by Yao Jin for the upper bound of the second order, and finally by Funer and Solovay for the lower bound for the second terms. However, from the ground state energy, this still not easy to get some inside information for the ground state. So let me give an overview and outlook of the talk. So I already explained to you that in the gravitational regimes, then the excitation spectrum of an interacting gas can be effectively described by the spectrum of a one-body operator, and this coincides with Volobov approximation. So in terms of the proof, we can renormalize the short-range interaction potential by a longer range, and then this means that starting from the dilute regime, we can end up with a mean field regime. For the latter, you can apply the original approach of Volobov to diagonalize the corrected Hamiltonian and obtain the excitation spectrum explicitly. So I hope that this approach will be some insight to the Bose gas in the thermodynamic limits. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you for your attention.